Good morning, San Pedro, and welcome to First Presbyterian Church's worship service as we're streaming live. I just wanted to say hi. Hi to a couple people I know who are already on our stream via Facebook. I saw Sharon, I saw Kristen, I saw Eric. Christy's back in the back there, and she's streaming live, so welcome. Thanks for being here. Thanks for joining us. Some of you may be joining us later on in the morning, maybe later on in the week, but we're glad that you're tuning in, and we hope that you'll be able to worship God in the midst of this. It's fun being in the midst of the sanctuary. It kind of gives me a little comfort. We do not know if we will do this next week because government agencies may say we need to do something differently. So we'll see, but we'll keep you posted on that. For now, we're live here at First Press's sanctuary. Let me make a couple announcements. One, no activities here at the church due to the restrictions that we have of staying at home. Also, don't forget that we could still use your offerings via the mail and or given online because we still have our expenses, but we aren't passing a plate, so your help in that would be greatly appreciated. And then lastly, on Tuesday at 6:30, we're going to do a Zoom prayer gathering. So if you want to be a part of a prayer gathering on Tuesday at 6:30, shoot me an email here at the church, and then I'll instruct you how you can log on to the Zoom account, and you can join us, and we're going to pray for a half hour, just like we usually do. But it would be great to have more than just a few people gathering. We could have up to 100 that are a part of the Zoom gathering. So that's all I can think of. Just know that there's no activities, like I said earlier, no volleyball, no softball that's coming up. We do not know when things are going to be starting up again. But we're going to play it by ear, and when we get the green light to do more things gathered together, we will do that. And with that, let's now prepare our hearts to worship God. To worship with these words. You may have these printed in the feed that's at the bottom of our Facebook page, so if you want to follow along, you can. It'll have the words to the hymns in there too. So here now, as we are called to worship, Let us worship God, for whom our souls thirst and our bodies long. Listen, listen to me, and your soul will delight in the richest affair. We have come to hear the word God has sent. God's word will not return empty, but will accomplish through us his holy purpose. Let us worship God in spirit and in truth, and then we will go out with joy and be led forth in peace. The mountains and the hills will sing, the trees in the field will clap their hands. And so now, let's worship our God by the singing of Morning Has Broken. Pray with me. All-knowing and all-caring God, we are parched from another long week. We are parched like a desert, empty and in need of replenishment. So Lord, we ask now that you would visit us with your presence. May your Holy Spirit fill us, may it strengthen us, so that we might be able to worship you in spirit and in truth in these next moments. So be with us, in Jesus' name.
Thank you.
The time in our worship service where we offer a prayer of confession. It's a prayer of confession that we usually do together as we're gathered because we realize corporately we sin, but we also do that individually. And so this is a prayer that we can do both corporately as I'm reading it out loud, but also individually. And so I'll give you a couple moments too in the midst of our, at the end of the prayer, just to offer your own prayer of personal confession. So join me now in that prayer of confession. If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, O Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness. Therefore you are feared. I wait for the Lord. My soul waits for the Lord. And in his word I put my hope. My soul waits for the Lord more than the watchmen wait for the morning. More than the watchman waits for the morning. Almighty God, our Redeemer, in our weakness, we have failed to be your messengers of forgiveness and hope. Renew us by your Holy Spirit so that we may follow your commands and proclaim your reign of love through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. And now offer your own prayers, a personal confession to our God. Lord, these words from the psalmist remind us of our situation, our status before you, that you are a God whom we should fear, but also you are a God who is forgiving and loving. So Lord, in the times where we forget to love you, when we forget to love our neighbors as ourselves, we ask, Lord, to forgive us. May we not walk in fear, but may we walk in love, knowing that you are walking with us. So Lord, thank you for being a God who hears our prayers and forgives our sins. Amen. Now hear these words of assurance of pardon. Those who love me, I will deliver, says the Lord. I will protect those who call on my name. When they call me, I will answer them. I will be with them in trouble. I will rescue them and honor them and show them my salvation. Receive the good news that in Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Amen. Now let's sing Gloria Patri. Next want to do is move on to a time of prayer. And we know there are many ways in which we can be praying for one another. Most importantly, we are isolated from one another. And I think the biggest thing for me is I like being around people. And so it's hard for me to be by myself. I am with my family, and my house is very full. So I got that going for me. But I know there are many people who are just, they are by themselves in their apartments or homes. And it's tough to get connected with other people. And so we want to pray for that. We want to pray for those that are ill because of the coronavirus, and it's happening all around us and around our world. And so we'll pray for that. We'll also pray for things that are going on in the life of the church as we respond to this crisis in our lives. So join me now in prayer. Lord, we do ask that you'd be with us as we are in the midst of a crisis. It's a worldwide crisis. It's something that is affecting all of us directly in some way. And so, Lord, we pray that you will help us in the midst of that. Lord, we first of all want to pray for those that are ill, for those that are affected by the virus. Our prayer is, Lord, that the virus would not be so overwhelming that people could not overcome the illness and be whole once again. Lord, we pray that we would be wise in the way that we're dealing with one another, too, that we would isolate ourselves, that we'd stay away, especially if we are sick, and Lord, that we'd heed our government officials and listen to them and what they are saying, because Lord, we don't want this to be a pandemic that kills many, many people. So Lord, be with us in the midst of this virus, and be with us in the midst of figuring out how we live life differently. Lord, we do ask that you be with us as we do go about our routines, and that we pray for safety, that we'll keep our distance from people, that we'll be able to get the things that we need. And when we aren't able to do that, that people would come alongside us and share, sounds silly, but share toilet paper, share cans of beans or whatever we need in our homes. So Lord, we pray for that and ask that we might be giving in the resources that we have to one another. Lord, we also do want to pray for people who are in hospitals, and it's totally unrelated to the virus. They're there because of treatments for cancer or for a heart ailment, other situations. And Lord, they are the ones that are most at risk. And so Lord, we pray for them and ask that you protect them and look out for them. We ask, Lord, that you be with the medical people in the medical field, that you would look out for them, protect them, give them the strength that they need, because they are working long hours and are vulnerable too. Lord, we pray for the resources that they need, from masks and for blood and for other things that are necessary as they deal with people. And so, Lord, we pray for those resources. Lord, we also do pray for people that are distanced from us, that we haven't been in contact with for a long, long time. I think of my cousins and my friends who I just want to make sure that they're doing okay. And so, Lord, may we reach out to them. And even though it's been a long time, may we reach out to them and call and let them know that we love them. Lord, we also want to be praying for our world and for things going on in the world. We know that people are still recovering from natural disasters like a tornado in Nashville and other disasters. And Lord, even though the virus is high on the list of things that are going on in our world, we know that there are people who are suffering because of other situations. Lord, we also do pray for men and women who are serving away from their families, whether it's in the armed forces or whether it's just in the front lines of our first responders. Lord, we ask that you be with them and protect them and look out for them. And Lord, we do pray for our church, for the church that isn't gathered, but that is seeking to be loving to one another. May we do that in ways that are new and different. And may we reach out by phone, by texting, by video chatting, whatever it might be, so that we might know that we are loved and cared for by one another. And Lord, we pray especially for those that are isolated and can't get out, or we can't even visit them because they don't have access. And so Lord, we pray for that. We pray that for our church, but we pray that for every church here in San Pedro. We pray for that in all the churches throughout Los Angeles, throughout the nation, around the world. We pray, Lord, that we might be your church in big and small ways. Lord, we also do pray for the way that we are doing worship and the way that we are trying to connect with one another. It's hard, it's difficult, especially for leaders that are trying to figure out how to do church differently. And so, Lord, we pray for that and ask that you be helping us to reach out to our flock in different and creative ways.
hear us now as we pray the prayer that we taught your disciples praying. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Peace, my God.
words of comfort and to be reminded that God is with us. Let me start by asking, so what has it been like for you this past week? I need to say, for myself, it has been a bit strange, hunkering down at home, not doing my daily routines, not being able to do the things that I normally do, and always in the back of my mind, is this the day that I should venture out to Costco to go get toilet paper? I think we're still good for about another 2 weeks at our house, but there's going to be a time that I need to go get that toilet paper. Wednesday, I ventured out and went to go look for, I just wanted some, we needed milk and we needed eggs. And it took me to go to 4 stores. Finally, I said, okay, I'm going to wait in line at Trader Joe's. I waited 30 minutes and I got 1 dozen eggs and 1 gallon of milk, and that was it. But I got to say, life is different. Even in my house backs up to a park, and there's people walking by through the park on a daily basis. My dog lets me know every person that walks through the park because every person gets a bark from her. But her barking, I don't know if it's because I'm home more or because there are more people, but there are more people walking through our park now. And I see people that are walking by that I've never seen before, that I didn't even know they lived in my neighborhood. So that's something else. And then people are working out in the park that usually go to a gym, and so that's kind of interesting to watch. Anyways, I've also been worried about my neighbors, maybe just like you've been worried about your neighbors. I have, you know, a neighbor probably in her 80s. She walks her dog, Lovey, which is my dog's favorite little buddy. And so I just wondered how Jean was doing and everything was okay at their house. And so when I got to see her, I was kind of relieved to know that she's doing fine, her husband's fine, neighbors have been looking out for them and been able to get them the necessities that they need. But life here at church has even been different. I know in the Meals on Wheels office, they've had a lot more phone calls. People have been asking, can you deliver a meal for free? And we don't do that for free. So Kristen's been having to answer those phone calls. The Kids Kingdom Preschool's been meeting because some parents just need to have some care for their kids, but the classes are about half full. And even as I'm planning for worship, it seems like I'll plan for worship one way, and then by the end of the week, I probably should be doing it a different way. I'm thinking about Palm Sunday. Palm Sunday is off as far as the choir presentation. We're going to push that off all the way to the end of May, probably. And Easter is going to be different. I don't think we're going to have an Easter service here, so we'll do an Easter service via live streaming somehow. And I know that it's not just here in California that things are different. It has been kind of doing church differently all around the world. In fact, it was back on February 29th that a friend of mine in Japan, who works at a church there, said that they had decided as a church leadership to close their church to any church activities and not have worship service. And that was, you know, at the end of February. And so here we are in California now, and we are in the same boat. But Steve went on to say that the closing of the church didn't mean that the church stopped being the church. It didn't mean that ministry stopped. Social distancing didn't mean that relational distancing was taking place. He wrote that he was looking forward to the creative ways in which God was going to use his people to connect with one another and to be his people in this time. He asked for prayers for those that were suffering because of the COVID-19 and for protection, and also for protection that this disease wouldn't spread. And so that's our prayer now, is that we'd listen to our government officials, that we'd social distance, that we'd hunker down at home, and that we would help this disease, kind of the curve flatten out, as they're saying, so that the disease won't affect more and more people. Which brings us to our scripture today. Steve also said that Psalm 91 was kind of the scripture for their church, especially during this time. And it's definitely God's word for this season at this time. It reminds us that God is our shelter, that he covers us with his protection. There is no fear when we trust in God. And with that, hear now God's word from Psalm 91. You who live in the shelter of the Most High, who abide in the shadow of the Almighty, will say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. For he will deliver you from the snare of the fowler, from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with his pinions, and under his wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness is a shield and buckler. You will not fear the terror of the night, or the arrow that flies by day, or the pestilence that stalks in darkness, or the destruction that wastes at noonday. 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you. You will only look with your eyes and see the punishment of the wicked, because you have made the Lord your refuge, the Most High your dwelling place. No evil shall befall you, no scourge come near your tent, for he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. On their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your feet against the stone. You will tread on the lion and the adder. The young lion and the serpent you will trample underfoot. And those who love me, I will deliver. I will protect those who know my name. And when they call me, I will answer. I will be with them in trouble. I will rescue them and honor them. With long life, I will satisfy them and show them my salvation. This is the word of the Lord, and thanks be to God, and let's pray. Lord, we ask that you be with us as we have opened up your word now, and we ask, Lord, that you'd be with us as we seek to hear you in a new and fresh way. So be with us, and may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our heart be acceptable to you, our Lord and our God. Amen. Well, in times of crisis, the ancient nation of Israel would gather at a sacred place, and there, led by their priests and their leaders, they would plead to God for protection. They would seek God's guidance and intervention and his deliverance in a time of need. And it could have been because of an enemy nation or a plea for the sinful to stop sinning and for righteous living to take place. And the question was, what shall we do, God? We need you now more than ever. Be with us, Lord, deliver us. And that's the setting of this psalm. It's a psalm that is a plea to God for protection. And it's a psalm that should be coupled with Psalm 90. So Psalm 90 and 91 go together. Psalm 91 is the assurance that God is going to look after them after their plea in Psalm 90. So when you get the chance, read the two psalms together. And the theme that is given in this psalm is seen in verse 2. And it's that God is the source of refuge and a fortress in the midst of trouble. God is a source of refuge and a fortress in the midst of trouble. He is our deliverer. He is our protection. Now think with me for a second. What are the different images that come to mind when you are threatened or scared? Maybe it's an image that comes to mind where you need some shelter from a storm that's battering your home, and you're safe and warm and protected in that home. Or maybe the image comes to mind where you are threatened by the playground bully, and there your friends come alongside you and say, stop bullying my friend, and they stick up for you and they protect you. Or maybe the image comes to mind of an army surrounding a city-state, and nothing is going to penetrate that army. The psalm doesn't ignore that there are troubles in life. Throughout the psalm, there are a number of troubles that are talked about. There are the snares of the hunter's trap, the threat of disease and of illness, the fear that comes in the night when darkness is all around. And even in day when arrows are flying and disaster seems a right at hand, those arrows will fall by the wayside. There are wild beasts that threaten, snakes that are ready to bite with their venomous poison. But these threatening images of destruction are balanced by a collection of images of divine protection. There's the mother bird that is shielding her young with her wings. In the midst of the battle, there's God's armor and his shield of protection. God's angels will guard a path that is walked on so that we don't stumble. God will deliver. God will cover. God will look out. God will command. God will protect. God will answer. God will be with us. God will rescue. God will honor. God will satisfy. And God will show his salvation. That one image of God being an eagle or a hen is something that I want to just focus in on for a moment. You know, it's the image of a mother bird who is looking after her young ones. And bird experts say that this is a very common instinct for birds. And a bird, when it senses a predator coming and that there's something that's falling, or something that's falling from above, instinctively spreads out her wings and makes like a canopy for her young ones to find cover there. And the move is so instinctive and deeply ingrained in a bird that they'll do that even if there's no babies around. I see this image all the time when my wife and I go for a walk around this lake that's nearby us with our dog especially. You know, there'll be ducks or there'll be little ducklings or goslings that are there. And when they feel threatened, they'll run to their mom, and especially when my dog's in tow with us, and there are honks and quacking and hissing that come from their beaks, and the wings spread out, and they look out like they are protecting their young. And that's the image that the psalmist gives as he writes that God is like that mother hen, like that that is looking out, and we can find shelter under the wings of God from the dangers above. He will defend, he will protect, he will keep us safe. And it reminds us that someone else is in charge. Someone that is bigger, that is stronger, that is more experienced, and who will never go away. Is never off duty. Now, a reality check of life reminds us that faith in the shelter of God's protection doesn't mean that we're not going to experience physical dangers, or that there aren't dangers that are around us. We need to take precautions. We can't ignore thieves or encounter with wild animals or difficult situations. I'm reminded of that time after time as a pastor. I may preach a sermon that emphatically states that God is going to look after us, that he's going to protect us, and that he is faithful, and that he is trustworthy. But red flags go up for people all the time when I say that, because they aren't feeling protected and they aren't feeling safe. God, they say, may be your protector, Tim, but he's not my protector. And right now, I am feeling threatened in my life. There's family tragedies. There's career disappointments. World events that cause people to ask, so where is God in this situation? Where is God that he's supposed to be my protector? And sometimes it makes me feel like I'm working in the customer service of a department store, and I'm the one on the phone who's taking the phone call that says, I'm really disappointed with the service that I'm getting, and I listen sympathetically, I apologize for the management, and I try to sort things out, reassuring them that everything's going to be okay and everything's going to be all right. But it's hard, and when we face difficult times, it is difficult to realize that God is our ultimate protection. Here's a little side note in regard to God's protection. In Matthew chapter 4, Satan tests Jesus in the second temptation, and he quotes, when Jesus quotes against Satan, against this temptation, he's quoting from Psalm 91. Jesus is at the pinnacle of the temple, and Satan says, throw yourself down. And Jesus says, because it says in Psalm 91, God will give his angels charge over you. And Jesus replies that it's not right to put God to the test. Jesus was teaching us that we cannot act like a fool and then count on God to bail us out. God may do that, and some of us can recall times when we have acted like a fool and God does bail us out, but we cannot count on that. We know that in life we get hurt, and sometimes hurt by no fault of our own. We all know of stories of devout Christians who, in the prime of their lives, visit the doctor, who is concerned about something and then sends them off to a specialist who does tests, and then that specialist comes back and says, there are things that you need to be concerned about. And finally, it comes back to your primary care doctor who says, you know, it might be good that you get your affairs in order. Where are the wings of God's protection in that situation? How can God take away a mother, a wife, a daughter before her time? Where is God when someone gets brain cancer or is raped or is robbed at gunpoint? Where are the wings of God's protection that we read about in this psalm? What troubles us is the fact that believers suffer along with everyone else. Believers in Christ do take their share of the world's sufferings. In fact, our reading of the scripture, along with our experience, has taught us that we can expect to face times of trouble, to have hardships in our life. What worries us is that Psalm 91 doesn't tell us not to worry. It says, 1,000 may fall by your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near to you. It's an advertisement that sounds good, too good to be true. In fact, the psalmist says, because you have made the Lord your refuge, no evil will touch you. But Psalm 91 gives us part of the picture of the grand scheme of faith. The psalm expresses one aspect, one beautiful and lovely psalm that reminds us that God is our protection. But it's also coupled with the times where a psalmist cries out and says, God, where are you? I need you in the midst of this trouble. There are going to be times where there is darkness and times where we don't feel protected by God. And those are times where we can cry out to God and cry out in despair, where we feel like we're abandoned by God. And with quiet amazement, those psalms bear witness that God will be with us, that good things do happen to bad people, but in the end, God is with us. And Psalm 91 reminds us of that. We can also read all of scriptures, and we get the big picture, and we come to see that in the end, God is our protection. God will be with us. He'll be with the brokenhearted. He'll be with those that are suffering because of disease. And we can look back to the saints of the church from generation to generation and see that God is faithful, that God is trustworthy. And we don't have to be scared because we know that we are under God's protection. We may be battered, we may be bruised, but we will be all right because we are under the wings of God. Let me conclude with some thoughts that will remind us that can be with us in the midst of these difficult times. First, remember that God is our ultimate protector. In the midst of crisis, whether it's an illness or a financial difficulty or some other crisis in our life, the scriptures remind us over and over again that God is with us. He will protect us. There's something that's reassuring knowing that there's something bigger out there that is looking after us. So even if you feel like you are outnumbered, that you are overwhelmed by life circumstances, know that God is on your side and he will be with you. Read some of the scriptures that remind us of that. Go and read Psalm 23. Say the Lord's Prayer. When we read that prayer, we're reminded that our daily needs will be met, just like a father looks out after his children. They're simple reminders that God is looking out for us. Second, we need to have words of affirmation from one another. I know that in the midst of our isolation, I tend to dwell on those times where I don't have. And when I'm reached out by someone, whether it's a phone call or a text, I'm reminded that I'm loved by someone. So even though we can't have face-to-face connections, let's look out for one another through phone calls, through text, through FaceTiming. Make those phone calls so that someone knows that there's someone out there that cares for them. And those words of encouragement can go a long ways. And then third, consider acts of service for others. You know, check in on each other frequently. One of the things that we're going to be doing as church leadership is just to make sure that everyone in our church family is okay. They're going to be making phone calls. Maybe you've already received one of those phone calls. Just checking in to see if there's anything that you need. And if there is something that you need, let us know, and then we'll try and fill that need. And it could be as simple and silly as toilet paper. But we'll get it for you. But we need to do that for one another. And we need to do that for our neighbors down the street. We need to keep our social distances, but acts of service can be a reminder that God is looking out for us as we do that for one another. So, in conclusion, may you feel loved, and then may you love. May you feel protected, and may you protect. And with that, let's pray. Lord, we do ask that you be with us as we navigate this new way of living life. May we always be reminded that you are our ultimate protection. So even though we may fear, like that things are surrounding us and things are going wrong, Lord, we ask that you be with us. May we remember that you are our ultimate protection and that we can trust in you in the midst of life's difficulties. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, as we go on with our worship service, it's at this time that we ask for the tithes and offerings. And one of the things I'll ask you to do is, if you can do that, to do so by mailing in your tithe or by doing it online. You can go to the church's website and find the giving tab and then give that way. But as we give, we do so out of the abundance and the ways that God has blessed us. And our response back is to further his kingdom work. Whether it's here at this church or whether it's taking place in our community, we want to be people who are doing God's work, and those tithes and offerings help us to do that. So we do this all with joy in the midst of what's going on in our lives. Amen. Mighty God, you are the one who has given us so much. You've blessed us in so many ways, and we are overwhelmed by your love and your mercy that you pour out to us, your blessings that come to us each and every day. So, Lord, we ask that you would that we would be good stewards of what you have given to us here at this church, that we might use those gifts wisely in furthering your kingdom work that takes place here in this church campus, but also out in the world, so that your kingdom may come here on earth
here on earth, just as it is in heaven. We say this in your Son's name. Receive it just as if you're receiving a cup, a blessing. And as I have my hands raised, I want you to receive this blessing now from the Lord. And let me quote from Psalm 91, those opening verses. You who live in the shelter of the Most High, you who abide in the shadow of the Almighty, will say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. And so now I say, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you, now and forever. And all of God's people said, Alleluia. Amen.
Shine upon you and be great.
as we're ending, have a great week. Stay isolated, but reach out to one another. Text, phone, call people. If there is something that you need, reach out to me. I know you all have my number somewhere, and so you can call me, text me, and I'll get the word out to see if we can help in some way. And be safe, be healthy, and may God be with you throughout this week. See you in a while.